Welcome to Talks at GS. I'm honored to be joined today by my friend, David Cote. Dave was chairman and CEO of Honeywell. Shortly after his retirement, we were privileged to partner with Dave to co-sponsor our first SPAC, Goldman Sachs Acquisition Holdings Corp. In February of this year, the SPAC purchased Vertiv Holdings, a global provider of products and services to data center and telecommunications customers. Dave now serves as executive chairman of Vertiv. Dave is now out with a fantastic new book called Winning Now, Winning Later, How Companies Can Succeed in the Short Term While Investing for the Long Term. Dave, thank you so much for being here with us today.
Well, thank you.
Let's turn now, Dave, to the book. So the book's thesis might be described as overcoming short-termism in management. This balance of investing in areas that you knew would be successful in the short term while also investing for the future was a hallmark of your time at Honeywell. Can you talk about a few examples of each type of investment from your tenure there at Honeywell as we talk about this thesis of short-termism and sort of coexisting short-term and long-term investing?
Yeah, sure. Well, I should back up a little bit and say one of the premises, as you know, of the book was this approach that we use to run everything in Honeywell, and that's that success is always about achieving two seemingly conflicting things at the same time. And everybody always wants to know, hey, boss, what's the one thing you want me to do? But the answer is always there's these two things you have to do, and it's not a balance. You have to figure out how to do both. And you know, examples that I use are, do you want low inventory or do you want great product delivery for customers? Do you want people closest to the action empowered for quick decisions, or do you want good control so nothing bad happens? Do you want good short-term results or do you want good long-term results? In every case, the answer is you want both. So you have to figure out how to do both. And one of the things that drove me crazy reading anything that had out there about short-termism was they made it sound like you had to choose. You had to choose to either be short-term or you had to choose to be long-term. They make it sound like it's mutually exclusive. And my view has always been they're mutually reinforcing. And if you start to look at things that way and you change your own headset as a leader, then you start to figure out how to do that. So one of the sort of things that we did in Honeywell is from a short-term basis, one of the big things that I focus on is grow sales and hold fixed cost constant. Now, simple math to do, because if you look at any business, the variable margins are, we'll say, in the 35 to 70% range, depending on the kind of business that you're in. So if you can hold your fixed cost constant, that fall through at 35 to 70% is huge. And it gives you tremendous flexibility to provide returns to share owners or bosses, whatever level you're at, and to be able to reinvest. So we focused on that early. And as we talked in one of the partner meetings, we were able to actually take the major functional costs, so think of HR, legal, finance, IT, down by about $1 billion, not in inflation-adjusted numbers, but actual reduction over the course of 16 years, while improving service levels, again, trying to do two seemingly conflicting things at the same time. That gave me the flexibility to provide returns to share owners. So if you look at how the stock performed over 16 years, first 5 or 6 years, we slightly outperformed the S&P 500, but it allowed me to start priming the machine, priming the pump, if you will, and with new products and services, globalization, process effort, and we invested in things like hydrofluoroolefins, the HFOs, the non-ozone depleting low GWP type stuff, all the refrigerants, all the aerospace platforms that we're now on, which are only starting to come to fruition, everything we did in gas detection, in intelligent warehousing. I mean, it gave us the opportunity to do all of those things. And as a result of that, that seed planting in the long term, you can see in the last 10 years of the 16, we crushed the S&P 500 because all that stuff starts paying off.
Yeah, no, it's a good example. And I just want to now talk about some of the sustainable investing you did. And you mentioned it just in the comments, you know, just now. But you and I have talked about a key component of long-term investment is to operate sustainably over time. You believe companies have a social responsibility, a key component of sustainability, to the communities they serve, in addition to the investments they make for economic purpose. Obviously timely given the heightened focus on racial injustice at the moment. What role does the private sector have to play in these very important issues? And just talk about it from your vantage point as a CEO, you know, running a company, a large company, and playing in the community while trying to deliver returns for shareholders.
Yeah. Well, all of us, in effect, have a license to operate from society. So we can't just say, look, I'm going to run my business. I really don't care what happens out there. You can't do that because that's the context that we have to operate within. That being said, I also think the stakeholder focus, which when I first read the BRT statement, I said, well, no big deal. You know, anybody who runs their business intelligently has to be thinking about all these things. I mean, you got to be thinking about customers, suppliers, communities, employees. You have to be. But wow, it's gotten way out of hand in terms of what they expect companies and CEOs to do and say. Now, I always thought it was important to do. So if you take a look at while we went from $20 billion to $120 billion, we also spent $10 billion addressing all of our asbestos liabilities, investing $5 billion in our pension plan, which was like 79% funded when I got there, because I felt like that we had to do that to maintain fidelity with our employees and retirees. We promised them that we were going to pay this, and I didn't want to be the guy who didn't pay them. We also had all the environmental liabilities that you'd have with a 100-year-old chemical company. And the strategy had been to fight in court until you lose and then pay. And I thought that was wrong. It's not who I wanted to be. It's not who I wanted the company to be. So we spent 15 years and $3.5 billion to fix all those things. But I did all that within the context that this is the right thing for shareholders, because this is positioning the company better for the long term. I don't want my successor to have to deal with these kinds of time bombs. So I still do all of this within the context of the share owner. And I'm fearful that it's getting a little carried away. And then what will happen is that US companies, US CEOs, will start to use stakeholder focus for an excuse for not performing for share owners. And if we get to that point, then everything starts falling apart, because business is the source of productivity in the country, and productivity is the source of standard of living. It's what gives you the flexibility to grow your economy and provide the resources that you need to fix all the issues that we have.
So let's reflect back on your time at Honeywell. When you arrived at the company in 2002, you assessed that it required a lot of fixing, starting with the company's mindset. So just talk about why you started with the company's mindset. Why there?
Yeah, we had an interesting culture, and it was a legacy Allied Signal, legacy Honeywell, and legacy Pittway, three companies that had been brought together over the course of a couple of years, never integrated. And as a result of that, they were always warring. There was always just, in fact, I can remember being asked in one of my first town halls as I was going around trying to figure out what was going on. And I was asked, so Dave, are you red or are you blue? And I just moved there from Kentucky. And all I could think of was, this is University of Louisville versus University of Kentucky. Why are they asking me this? And it finally dawned on me, it was red Honeywell versus blue Allied Signal. And that's when I realized, okay, we got an issue. So I spent time up front developing the five initiatives that I talked about: growth, productivity, cash, people, and our enablers. But I also thought, you know, I got to get people working together. And the thing that can unite them, instead of arguing about who's right, is to put this in terms of an external context. So I used the customer and said, okay, we've all been customers. We all buy stuff. We understand what it's like to be a customer. All our conversations are going to revolve around what's right for the customer here. And to facilitate that, we created these 12 behaviors. And even we were joking as a staff at the time that God only needed 10 commandments, but we needed 12 to fix the culture at Honeywell. But at the end of the day, it ended up being an important step. And I can remember getting a question from one of my own staff members. It was like second month I was there, and we were plowing through it as a staff for the day to say, okay, what do we want our behaviors to be? And he said, Dave, why are we focusing so much on these behaviors and culture when we've got all these strategic issues that we have to address? And my comment to him was, look, I can make all the strategic decisions you want, but if nobody does them, then it really doesn't matter. So we've got to kind of create this mindset that whatever we say we're going to do, we figure it out, make sure we focus, but then we actually go do it. And if we don't have the right kind of culture, the right kind of mindset to do that, you just never get there.
So you also talk about what you mean by losing sight of the business intent underlying a goal. This really resonated with me, I have to say, when I read it. You talk about compliance with words, not compliance with intent. And just unpack that, because I think it was an important sort of philosophy in the book that really does resonate in terms of, you know, saying things versus really meaning them and dealing with the intent of what's underlying the strategy or the perspective or whatever. Just talk a bit about that in terms of how that framed itself for you at Honeywell.
Yep. I think it's an important item for any large organization because large organizations become very adept at complying with whatever the boss or CEO has asked for and having it really just be an appearance of compliance, not actual compliance with what you're trying to do. The corollary to that one that I oftentimes use is if you measure something, the metric will get better. In other words, it doesn't necessarily get better. The metric gets better because people learn how they're measured and they learn how to manipulate the metric. And you see it on everything. For example, one of my favorites is we want 50% of sales to come from products introduced in the last 5 years. Sounds terrific. Well, you start to get into it and find managers go, oh my God, well, we don't have enough R&D to do all that. I'll tell you what, we'll change the packaging on this from blue to red. That changes the SKU number. Then the system calculates it as a new product. And organizations become very adept at that. The intent was to drive a bunch of new products into the marketplace. What the organization does is say, oh, okay, I got to comply with this metric. How do I get there? You see the same thing happen with delivery metrics. You see it happen when you do something like say, okay, I want every employee to have an appraisal by year end. Well, what's the implicit assumption in that? That it's going to be a good, well thought through appraisal. Well, managers end up learning, oh, geez, you know, I got to get the appraisals done, dash them off, get them in the system. Okay, ditto. Check with the employee. Did you have a discussion? Yeah, might have been 5 minutes, but they have to say, yes, we had a discussion. What was the intent of that? It was for the boss to spend at least an hour developing a thoughtful appraisal of the employee's performance, and then spend an hour with the employee on, here's how to think about it. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. Here's the stuff you're really good at, do more of. Here's the stuff I want you to think about. And organizations, big organizations in particular, become extraordinarily adept at complying with words because they got 80 hours worth of work, 60 hours to do it. Okay, I got to get this done, dash it off, done. I got my compliance with words. And it's one of the things that's endemic to large organizations. It probably doesn't happen at Goldman, but.
No, I think it happens in every organization. That's why it resonates, because I think, to your point, you set out a metric, people run to the metric because they're action-oriented. They want to hit the goal. Doesn't mean that they're hitting the intent, though, to your point, which is why that's why I wanted you to unpack it, because it's important. Talk about the Honeywell operating system, how you came to it, what the thought process was, and the impact it's had on the company.
Yeah. Well, as you know, I used to take 2 to 3 full days a year where I would just kind of sit and think about the company.
X days.
And for, right. I'm sorry?
X days.
Yeah, actually, they'd be a subset of the X days. I'd use them for what I call my blue book exercises. And I called it blue book just because I had an empty blue notebook that I would write in, nothing more than that. And I would just sit and think, and I'd usually get some material ahead of time, like, you know, headcount numbers or sales by geography, whatever, just as a way to help me think. And I tend to be an action-oriented individual myself also. taking the time, half day here or a full day there, to do that was not easy for me. I had to kind of force myself to do it. But I happened to be looking at a census report and just kind of trying to figure out, okay, where is everybody? What do they do? And in looking at it, I realized half our people were in manufacturing. And I had been an hourly employee and had a pretty good sense for how, what an unregarded entity hourly people tended to be in manufacturing in general in an industrial company. That was true at GE, where I spent a lot of years too and grew up in manufacturing originally. And I found myself just kind of thinking about, all right, well, what's the best way to engage half the workforce? And just kind of letting my mind go along, I said, geez, you know, I was always impressed with the Toyota production system. And at one point I thought, okay, if I ever got the head job at GE, I would do that there. And gee, why not do it here? So I sent a whole team to Georgetown, Kentucky, 60 people, maybe 70, to spend a week, 2 weeks, I'm sorry, with them to understand it. And they came back filled with the Holy Spirit. They just wanted to do all 250 plants, every single business, every single function. Everybody had to do this because it was just so good. And I'd say this is where my kind of go slow to go fast ended up working out really well, because I said, well, wait a minute. It's one thing for Toyota to do it. They've been doing this for decades. When they go in into a new plant, they interview 100 people for every one they hire. So they really get the kind of people they want. We're going into plants that can be 80 years old, average service 25 years. You don't tell somebody, hey, you work just the way you are right now through Friday, but adjust your headset on the weekend because Monday it's HOS and we need you to think differently. Culture doesn't change that fast. So we came up with a program, tested it in 10 facilities, brought it back after 6 months and said, gee, it worked in five, not in five others. How do we do it differently? Redid it, set it out to five, came back, had three that after 6 months, three that worked, two that didn't. Why? Then said, okay, now test this final model in two locations and make sure it works. And it did. And then we came back and said, okay, out of our 250 factories, we're going to start with 25. And we're going to make sure it works in all 25. And we're going to resource the hell out of those 25. And as they started to work and people saw improvement in cost, quality, delivery, inventory, and safety, then you had 225 other plants and plant managers and their bosses saying, gee, you know, we want to do the same thing. So you started to get that pull. And as a result of that, you get the compliance with intent that we were talking about before, as opposed to the compliance with words. It made a huge difference for us. And I'm on LinkedIn now, which I never thought I'd go on social media in my life, but the book kind of caused me to do it. And I'm amazed at the number of comments I get back from former Honeywell employees and current Honeywell employees about how much they loved HOS and what it did to change their life, change their career, change their how they thought about things. So it's been quite rewarding that way.
One of the things that we all, I think, observe coming out of this COVID crisis is a shift to more digital, whether it's e-commerce or, you know, even in the logistics world, there's just more things that are becoming more digital, probably quicker than even any of us might have imagined, you know, going in. You led Honeywell very much into the future when it came to technology and innovation during your tenure. What trends do you see having the most positive impact coming out of this crisis that you think might go even a little faster?
Yeah. Well, I probably ought to back up some and say for about 10 years now, I guess, I've been giving these presentations about three macro trends that I think are going to drive the century. The first one is the continuing strength of China and how we just have to always be thinking about that. And I don't think as a country we have a strategy for China. We've got a bunch of point-to-point solutions, but there is no strategy like we had for the Soviet Union, where we said containment was what we were going to do. There's no strategy for how to deal with China. South China Sea, we do this. Uyghurs, we need to do that. Cyber, okay, that's, there are too many in the universities. Okay, we're going to go do. There's no thought process, and it's a lot more complicated than anything we ever dealt with the Soviet Union. A second one is the population growing to 10 billion over the next 35 years. And that's going to mean more urbanization, more possibilities of pandemics, and we've got to feed all those people, and we need to be thinking about that, so positioning ourselves there. The third one is the rise of both digital and biology. And when you look at on the biology side, the sort of stuff that CRISPR technology is enabling, and that's going to continue to grow and get better, the biology changes are going to be just incredible. And you think about the ethics and social issues that come with that. We can talk about the vicious arguments over is abortion right or wrong now. What happens when it starts to, geez, you can pick IQ, you can pick hair color, you can pick size. What happens when Kim Jong-un decides he wants to have the perfect superhuman army? There's a lot of social issues coming with that, and we need to be thinking about that also. A piece of that is the digital side in that third item. The digital transformation, we're just at the beginning of it. If you assume the Industrial Revolution was, let's say, 100 years, we're 20 years into this digital revolution. We can't predict even where it's going to go. And as I like to say about futurists, they don't have to be right. They just need you to listen to them. So nobody really knows where this thing's going to go. And if you look at computing capability, and if you assume, okay, computing power will continue to expand double every 2 years, that doesn't sound like a lot. There are some people who will say that's not coming, but of course we have quantum computers coming, which Honeywell is very well positioned in. So if you say, okay, it doubles every 2 years, the human mind has a tough time dealing with that. So let's say, okay, if it doubles every 2 years, that says in 10 years, we have 32 times the computing power we do today. In 20 years, we have over 1,000 times the computing power we do today. Who can envision what you can do with 1,000 times the computing power? None of us. I mean, none of us can do it, but it's coming. So the changes here are just going to be huge. And it's why we positioned ourselves as much as we did at Honeywell to get into the software engineering. And my successor is doing a great job, as you know, on focusing on becoming a software industrial. So those things are going to continue. When it comes to COVID and what kind of impact is there going to be there, I think all the discussion about how working from home is going to become just the way we do things, personally, I think it's a lot of baloney, and that's going to change over time. It's, again, futurists talking about how things are going to go. I really don't think that's going to happen because it's just not how human beings are. Have you ever tried to tell a joke on Zoom with 20 people sitting around? I mean, they all fall flat. You're on mute, can't hear you. It's just not the same. Humans are meant to interact. So I don't think that's going to be a big phenomenon. I do think you're going to see a lot of changes on the medical side when it comes to speed of response on anything. So supply chain speed of response, whatever it is. So this time it was ventilators and masks. But what are all the other things that could happen? What if we get a waterborne disease? How are we gonna handle that? It'll involve how quickly can you become aware and tell everybody? How quickly can you figure out, does somebody have it or not? I mean, right now, having to wait 3-4 days to get the test results and find out that, oh, somebody talked to 200 people in that time that they were waiting, a speed of getting vaccines, those are where I think you're going to see more changes. And I'd like to see government putting money into that, too. That's the sort of thing they ought to be focused on.
Yep. Let me close, Dave, by asking you, can you share the best piece of advice you've received? You've had a long, successful career. You must have received a lot of advice over the years. Give us a tidbit on maybe the best piece of advice that's really stuck with you the longest, that's had the biggest impact on on your career.
Yeah. So I'm going to back up on this one a little bit too, and I've been asked many times, "Geez, who was the leader who had the most influence in terms of your leadership style?" And I realized early on that it was my mom and dad. And I always ended up saying, for the last 25 years, I've been saying, it's my mom and dad. And a key piece of advice that they gave me different ways, but it was the same message, My dad was constantly saying, be a leader, not a follower. And my mom was always saying, think for yourself whenever I wanted to do some stupid thing with my friends because they were doing it. It's irritating to hear as a kid because you hear it a bunch of times, you get sick of it. But the older you get, the more you realize how true it is. And the line that I use a lot is that independent thinking is a lot more rare than being smart. There's a lot of people who can learn stuff in school, do a great job taking a test, be able to explain to you why things are the way they are, or why people are thinking the way they are, or why this thing is right. A lot fewer people can look at all that same data and come to a different conclusion and say, geez, you know, I'm not sure that's right. And here's why. Nobody's really talking about this or thinking about that. So I would say that's the best advice I ever got. And it's one of the things that I think has helped me in my career is there are plenty of times when I've looked at things and come to a different conclusion than everybody else was. And it can be a lonely place because if you're wrong, I mean, you look like a complete fool. But in general, it worked out pretty well for me.
Yeah, I can say, having been in a lot of meetings with you, nobody will ever accuse you of not being an independent thinker. So that advice definitely stuck with you. Dave, I can't thank you enough for taking the time. You were generous with your time. Congratulations on the book. And we look forward to a good partnership going forward. And I hope you have a nice summer. Take care.
Yep, same to you. And thank you.